Hello everybody, Richard Michael Owen here at Owen Automotive, and we have an exciting new project here at the shop. It's this really early Jaguar XK motor that has a lot of really early design features. One of them being the front motor mount here. It's a cross brace that was changed early on in production. This was kind of a flawed design. And I'll get into that and more of these unique details as we take it apart. And that's the plan really today. What we're gonna do is disassemble the motor, carefully disassemble the motor, examine it for wear, show off some of the early details, and really build a plan for rebuild. So where did this motor come from? It came from a 1952 Jaguar fixed head that we dragged out of a barn. It had been sitting there for 40 years, actually alongside an alloy car, which we recently sold with Sotheby's. And yeah, it's gonna be a neat car. It's originally opalescent bronze with tan interior, and the plan is to take it back completely original. So what we wanna do is rebuild this motor. Don't wanna change it too much. Just refinish it, rebuild it as necessary. Not gonna go overboard, and I'm excited. Let's get into it. According to the cylinder head here, we can see W4520. That's the engine number. It should be right near the oil filter housing here. Let's see what we find. Let's wipe it off and have a look here. Oh, look at that. It's a matching numbers block and head, 4520-8. You can see here the dash was actually the number one. But yeah, so there we are, matching numbers. Let's dig a little further into this thing now that we know what we have. Okay, gonna take out the transmission and bellhousing unit. Don't want to put any unnecessary weight on it, just lightly support it from the bottom. Get the rest of the bellhousing bolts out, and it should just slide off. What we don't want to do is put any strain on the constant pinion shaft and bend it. We're recording, we're live. Okay, let's see what the clutch looks like and the pressure plate. There we are. Oh, the release bearing has barely anything left there. Yeah. So now we can have a look inside the bell housing here. A lot of oil deposits from the front seal of the transmission. The transmission oil has been leaking in here for a long time and making it a mess. The release bearing here, it's fully mechanical. That's why this rod protrudes right through the bell housing. And it's suffering. There's a graphite bearing there that's worn right down to the metal. So this would have needed to be replaced a long time ago. And it's been wearing right against this surface here and wearing it out. There's a groove in there, actually, I can feel it. So the pressure plate here, this is the 10-inch style spring pressure plate. We'll get that new with the clutch and the release bearing. It comes as a kit. Just having a look at the hardware here for the bell housing. These are all original B's bolts in black oxide, and that's how we'll refinish them. But one thing I want to talk about was this red paint or rust prevention. I don't know what it is, but I see it on a lot of the bolts that even came off the chassis, and it was originally there from the factory. So if anybody knows what that red stuff is, please let me know. Oh yeah, and look at the ground strap. It failed a long time ago, so we'll have to get a new one of those. And we got the original starter bolts here. I like reusing all the original hardware, refinishing it. It makes things go back together way faster and easier. Okay, just having a look at the flywheel here. It's pretty heavily grooved. It'll need a resurface. I got the 10 bolts here on a lock tab. Very similar to what we see with the E-types. My dad noticed the pilot bushing is just falling right out of there. Look at that. That's pretty easy to redo. There it is. Awesome. Thank you. So we're getting there, got the heavy parts off the back side of the motor, and I like to do that all while it's still on the engine hoist, don't want it tipping over. All the while we're developing a plan, all the parts we need. Have you guys been keeping track? We need a clutch kit, we need a flywheel lock tab, pilot bushing, and a ground strap. I had a good look at the flywheel on the bench. I don't think it's original to this car. It's not stamped with a serial number. It doesn't have any timing marks. And looking at the ring gear here, I think we're gonna need to do some work on this or have the machine shop do some work. If it would pull a focus, you can see a lot of the teeth are missing there on the top surface. And so the process is to machine the ring gear right off the flywheel, have the machine shop do that, and then press fit a new one on there. And yeah, it wasn't coming off very easy. If you have a look on the backside here, there's these big dowels, and that's why it has to kind of bang and wiggle off the end of the crankshaft. My next task is to deal with the top end of the motor, so the cylinder head. And the cylinder head is one of the things that I really like about this motor. It's the early style cylinder head that came from a foundry called William Mills. It kind of has these Siamese spark plug, I don't know what you call them, beds. And the studless cam covers, these things look really beautiful. They're studless because the later ones featured studs and acorn nuts all the way around the camshaft cover to stop the leaks. And I see all sorts of modifications like these small set screws and hold downs on the top here to prevent oil from spilling out. And I see I'm gonna be probably fighting some sealer too. So I'm gonna try to take these cam covers off without bending or warping them. They're extremely rare. And I think we're gonna try to fill these holes and make this car look back to original. Now, while the cylinder head's still attached to the motor, it's gonna give me a bit of leverage so I can take this manifold off. These get really stuck on. So I'll show you the process. We'll take out the studs and maybe that will help and assist with that. So yeah, really the next task is to get these cam covers off, and I see a lot of sealant here, so it might be a bit of a struggle. Okay, I've removed all the fasteners for the cam cover. I just want to take out this rear plug. That might help work it loose because it just will give it more room to move. Okay, light taps with the soft mallet here. Oh, it sounds pretty hollow. I think it's gonna lift off of there. Yeah, it's hollow all the way around, so I think it's just gonna lift right off. Oh, look at that. Okay, what do we got here? So make sure I got everything in view. Definitely see some deposits in there. So the engine's gonna be, you know, pretty well used, I imagine. I don't see any cracks though, so it looks like these things are gonna be reusable. Just have these holes in the end here to contend with. Gonna weld those up. Awesome. Okay, let's just have a quick look at what we've uncovered. Definitely have an oil bath in there. That's normal. That's what keeps the whole top end lubricated. Well, not too much drama here. Cams are looking good just from a visual perspective. See the upper timing chain here? Now, one of the guides here is busted off. That's not a big deal, though. That just helps locate it when it goes inward to remove the cylinder head. The lock wire... Now, that's not looking so good. That doesn't look like a professional job, so I don't know. We're likely dealing with maybe not a great rebuild. One of the cam followers is stuck down. One of the valves is stuck. Now, that's really common with these. That's why you don't want to turn the engine over until you make sure that the camshafts are out of the car and all the valves are actually free. Other than that, we're looking pretty good. You can see when you overly seal these engines, over here, it puts a buildup sometimes ingress, and like just like that there, it falls down into the motor and clogs up the oil pump. You can see right there too in that lubrication point down there, there's also some sealant stuck in there. So it's important not to use too much sealant when putting the cam covers on. But overall looking healthy, I would say. There we go. So now we can see why these intake manifolds get stuck on here. These are really long studs, and if there's a lot of rust in there, there's no hope of ever getting these off. With this one, look at that. Not a lot of corrosion. That's why I was able to just tap it off. Really sweet. We can see the part number here, C4953, and the William Mills number there. There's also some stampings up here in the corner. Not sure what those mean. Yeah, and the outlet pipe with the otter switch that controls the starting carb. On the inside here, let's see how the gasket was performing. See in the water jacket, quite a lot of corrosion. Yeah. Next up, I want to deal with these studs. I'm going to take them all out of the cylinder head, get them refinished, measure them all, because there's a lot of different lengths here and I want to put them back in the same spot. So I'm going to measure them and note where each one goes. Now, these studs typically come out of the cylinder head pretty easy. They're in there with a coarse thread. So for the most part, you can get them out, but if they won't budge for whatever reason, if I have to use too much force, then we'll use some heat. But I think they're going to back out. Let's see. First one here, look at that, just sliding out. No issues whatsoever. So there you go. So there you go, you can see the coarse thread in there. That's why these withdraw so easy. And when I reinstall them, I'll put them in with a little Teflon and they don't need to be really torqued in there. They just need to sit in place. So next up, I want to deal with the camshafts. I want to take them out. Have to deal with the timing chain, the timing gear, so I'll show you how that's done. But first, I just want to clean off the caps here. They have a stamping in them, and I want to make sure they all match. So I'll clean it up, and then we'll show you what is revealed. Now, after cleaning it up, we have the numbers matching. See that HP4 on the cap to the head? You got to make sure that those numbers are matching. They're the white right way around. Yes, the stampings need to be close together. Okay, let's continue on. So we're making progress, but we got a long way to go. Before I get ahead of myself, I just want to regroup. So figure out what we have, what we're going to do, and what we need to order. So I have all these aluminum pieces here on the bench. I'm going to clean them off with a process called walnut blasting. That is a real safe way to get rid of these oil deposits and not put any grit inside like the intake manifold here. I also took it apart. I was trying to take the otter switch out and of course the fasteners had corroded in and needed to weld the stud and get them out with welding, and luckily I got all those three out. Now another thing I did was I tested the back side of the intake manifold with a straight edge and it seems nice and flat. That's great. So I have to also consider my ordering, what I need to find. I don't know if you can order them, are the studless gaskets that don't have the holes here at the front. So I get a proper gasket for this really early engine. And lastly, just staying organized, bagging everything, and it's gonna go to its respective refinisher. Making good progress. Okay, next up I have to loosen the chain tension behind this breather cap. Believe it or not, is an eccentric cam that moves the center sprocket up and down. It'll loosen the tension on the upper chain. So let's crack into this. Give it a light tap, take it off. This is a constant area of leaking. These motors. Oh. I'll bring you guys in closer. We can have a look at this system. Okay, got a close-up here. You can see there's a lock bolt, Whitworth size, that needs to get loosened. And then I got to free up this other secondary lock. And then we can move this cam either way to reduce or increase the chain tension. Oh, that's really on there. There we go. Should be good. Sometimes this gets all rusted in place, so it might need some tapping. Gonna turn now. Let's see. Oh, it is. Okay, that stops freeing up a little more. That's what we want to see, is it that nice movement there. This isn't the best tool. We have a better one, but okay. And now we can see we have movement here. There we are. So that's freed up the chain completely. Nice. So what that means now, if you look at the top here, we can take off the sprocket, the cam sprocket. It's toothed. It has a tooth design in there. So we'll undo these nuts, a lock ring, and then we'll be able to move the sprockets inward. That's a pretty cool system. I'll show you what's going on. So I'm gonna explain that a little better. Okay, I got those two nuts off that had that crappy lock wire on them. And now I should be able to tap, just using this, tap the sprocket off of the end of the camshaft. There it goes. Let's get the other side. It's not on there by much. There we are. Next comes a cool part. So check this out. Now the sprockets are disconnected. We can tuck them in towards the center of the engine. See that? There we are. And now with them up tight in the center, that provides clearance so the cylinder head can come up and off with the camshafts on it without disturbing the timing. And it's a wonderful design. I love this. Okay, let's see if we can wiggle this camshaft free here. The cap. Whew, there it is. Lots to see here. We got the cam followers in their guides. They should be free moving like this. A couple are stuck down, so there's some drama there. Either the springs are broken or the valve is bent. Now, a lot of this system here that you see, it doesn't usually wear out, and it's perfectly acceptable, I think, just to reuse it. You know, maybe you can change the cam bearings. This one here, showing a little bit of, when you can start seeing lines in it like that and ridges, that's when it's time for replacement. But all the rest of the cam bearings look pretty good. The intake side here, yeah, pretty good, no drama. Now on the bench, I have the camshafts. I did a quick measurement. I measured about 5 thou difference between all the lobes, which is fine. I think these are reusable. They have 5/16 lift and they're marked SE. So I think these are camshafts have been added to the engine. I think it might have a longer duration. I'm not sure exactly what the SE camshaft difference was because it has the same lift as the standard spec. And again, we can see more of the camshaft bearings here. We'll probably end up replacing those. All right, cylinder heads coming off. Had to deal with some hardware here at the front. There's some studs poking through down here and some coarse thread bolts that go through and hold the front of the cylinder head on. So getting ready for liftoff, I took out 2 studs kind of at the ends of the cylinder head so it won't get cocked as we try to lift it up with this engine hoist. So let's apply some gentle pressure and see what happens. 3, 2, 1, lift off.
Oh, it's off.
It's coming off?
So lucky. It's up at the back 1/4 inch.
Okay, we got movement. Whoa. So it's still, it's coming off. Nice.
Get your plastic pry tool in there and just start lining it up. Oh, jeez, look at that, eh?
All too easy.
That is how it never come off like that.
Look at that.
God. You got a video of it coming up.
It is.
It's recording right now. Is it?
Oh, it's getting stuck on the timing gear here a bit. There you go. Oh, right on.
That head locker, eh?
Well, that cylinder head came off nice and easy. Sure happy about that. What was lurking underneath here, though, isn't so pleasant. What do I mean? Well, look at the rust down in the water jacket. This engine was run without proper antifreeze for a long time. It was actually attacking the steel cylinder head gasket. You see, it was just eroding away, and this was going to have a blowout in no time. So what can I say about the pistons? They look like the original domed pistons. You can kind of see the dome if I go down here. And they look like the original pistons. I can see the stamping on them, which was the sizing from the factory. Now the cylinder wall, it has an appreciable step here at the top, which means that we're gonna need new pistons and probably bore this engine out 20 thou over. Okay, so here we have the old head gasket, the one that was getting eaten away by coolant, and its replacement, which is a multi-layer steel gasket, MLS gasket from Kinetic. You can actually get these in 3, 5, and even 7 layers. And I think it's the way to go. This is kind of like a modern OEM style cylinder head gasket that'll be in your new car. You can really tell a multi-layer steel gasket because it has these tangs which overhang out. Got this cylinder head here on the bench. Now, a lot of people say this is improper storage, but for the short term, I think it's fine. The concern is warpage due to gravity. I'm not even sure if that's true, but if anybody has any definitive proof that aluminum warps due to gravity over time, please let us know in the comments below. So what do we got here? We got the cam followers. They're looking a little worn. I can see these round ridges dug into them. So probably get new followers. I just took the first one out here. You can see there's a shim in there and that gets the valve clearance, the right valve clearance. So I'll try to measure them all as I take them off. But this one at the end of the valve, I can see it's been ground down. Now that's because either the previous person didn't have the right shim or the valve seat is recessed too much. So usually a lot of machine shops would never do this. It's a big no-no. If they have to start grinding the valves, they just replace the seat outright because there's not a lot of clearance here between the keeper and the valve. And you want the valve to touch the shim. So yeah, what I'm gonna do is take out all these followers and let's check this head for warpage. Now that I got those followers out, I discovered a little bit of bad news, and that's that this cylinder head is warped. It's convex. That's really typical. These things kind of warp convex, so it's high in the middle. I'll show you what the stair straight edge is doing in the cam bearing journals, and on the surface here for the valve cover, it's just slightly warped, probably more than 10 thou. And, you know, that's one reason why these hold downs were put up at the front, because How are those cam covers supposed to seal all that oil, the pooled oil we saw here? If it was warped, then there was a huge gap at one end. So hopefully, fingers crossed, it's actually warped on the bottom so this whole thing can be straightened out altogether. Because if somebody has decked the bottom flat, that's going to make it a lot harder to correct this problem. So let's get this thing flipped over and check out the bottom. One thing I'm gonna do is take out all these studs. I really don't wanna get them bent. The studless cam cover is hypersensitive to these being bent or if they're the wrong height. So I'm gonna take them all out. We'll flip this thing over and see if it's okay on the bottom side. Got the cylinder head flipped over here. We can see part number C2242. That makes this the very first style of cylinder head that was fitted to the XK motor. There's a lot of corrosion here. These water jackets are not looking good. In fact, down here at the end, we can see that the coolant here has attacked the aluminum past the seal or almost right to the edge of the seal. So this is gonna need to be built up. This cylinder head's gonna need a lot of work. So what I'm gonna do next is I'll clean off one side, we'll get the stirred straight edge, and hopefully we'll see the same shape of warp so the cylinder head can all be put back straight. All right, I have to say I'm pretty disappointed. I cleaned up one edge here of the bottom of the cylinder head, and we have the straight edge on there, the stirred straight edge, and it's perfectly flat. Now, why is that? That's because whoever was machining this in the past had a warped head, they decked the bottom and they went forward, and that really is not smart. What the problem with that is that we have cam bearing journals, cam cover surfaces, they're all warped. And now we want to try to correct that, and it's going to be a lot more difficult with the deck being shaved completely flat. So what we're going to do is I'm going to clean up this cylinder head. We're going to get it through the parts washer. I'm going to get it walnut blasted, and my machine shop is going to try its best to unwarp it. Then if it can get unwarped, it has to be crack checked. It has to be welded. These water jacket areas need to be welded. They corroded too much into the seal surface. And then we can go through the whole regular process of valves and valve guides and valve seats. So it's going to be a big process to get this back to A1. We'll try our best with the original head. And yeah, that's the story of the cylinder head. I'm going to move on to the block now. So I got the engine on a stand here. Just makes it a little safer to work on and at a better working height. So what I got to do is take this water pump off. It has a bolt that's in behind the pulley here. Got to get this pulley off. It has a chunk missing out of it. I think I'm going to heat it up and use a puller. Let's see how that goes. Not a very hot flame here. Just enough to get things moving. I wonder if some gentle taps might do it. Yeah, it's off. Awesome. Okay, great. Little heat really helped there. Save the pulley. Okay, now we can see what's going on with that pulley removed. There's a very unusual bolt here that kind of slices right into the water passage there. And that's because this is the second version that was fitted to these XK engines. I'll show you what a first version looked like. It actually was a much slimmer design. And then when they needed to enlarge the flow, I guess, they enlarged the whole water pump right around this bolt here. And that's why it looks like a kind of a design flaw, really. Let's get it off. Okay, time to take the water pump off. I thought while it was attached to the engine, I'd remove this fitting. Well, it was so corroded, the fitting actually just fell apart, even though I heated it up around here. So I'm going to leave that in there because the water pump rebuilder will be able to deal with that. And that's a good point, actually, is this water pump, you send it out to get rebuilt. I'm not doing it myself. Let's see what the water jacket looks like. Light taps there. There we are. Pretty crusty, I must say. I think there's an adjustment here. You can measure the clearance here on the impeller to the body. But this one's going to get rebuilt in any case. Holy. Oh, it doesn't look so bad in there, does it? All right, next up, I want to deal with the crankshaft damper. There's rubber in here holding the outside to the inside, and it perishes, so it's always a good idea to replace crankshaft dampers. Now, I hope I can get this early style brand new. That remains to be seen. But I took off this crank nut. It has some dog drives here for a starting handle, which is really interesting because only the first 50 or so XKs, the aluminum ones, have a hole in the radiator, so you can use a starting handle on the engine. I guess it was just too big of an engine to start by hand. Here's a picture of my friend Michael with one in his hand. It was one of his favorite parts of number 53 there. So next I have to get this thing off. It's on a tapered fitting. They're usually not on that tight. I'm going to try a puller. Maybe a few taps. Let's see what a few taps do. Sweet.
There you go.
Good thing I put the foam down.
You foamed it.
Awesome. Okay, with that crank damper out of the way, we can look at the cross brace motor mount here. So what's interesting is that this is actually the second generation block, C4820. And one of the main differences are these extra holes for a proper motor mount. But at the time, I guess, the chassis were still being made to accept this cross brace. And it's not a great design. These things flex, they crack, and they're not a great design. So I can see why they moved to a more traditional mount like we see with the E-Type. In the end term, they put this small strut in here. I guess that helped the flex. But really, we can see the damage here. I think that this is supposed to be more to 45. And the whole motor and transmission, we're actually sitting a little rearward. We can see the rear mount is actually bent as well. So I can see why they wanted to update the design. That wasn't a significant enough motor mount for the weight of this whole unit. Okay, with the oil pan off now, we can take the timing cover off. It attaches onto the bottom of it. I'm not used to seeing these studs poking out. This is an early XK feature for that motor mount. But I think it should just slide off of here. Let's see how this goes. Okay, it's loose now. Gentle persuasion here. Okay, wow, look at this. So here we can see the two chains, the upper chain and the lower chain. The tensioner here, it's just a spring blade type tensioner, not really sophisticated. It kind of does the job though. I mean, it's somewhat loose. I mean, you can see its action there. Trying their best. This is before hydraulic tensioners, of course. And I don't know if it's on camera, but this is a really long distributor drive going down to the oil pump. Holy.
What are you doing?
Hey, sweetie pup. It's Oliver. Okay, I got all that timing gear out of the block here. We can see it's really dirty. A lot of grease and grime. It was a messy job getting that out. So I'm just trying to regroup, as I did earlier, and develop a plan for everything that came out. So we see the guides here that were down to the rivets. This is a rubber guide. It's down to the rivet. So that's no good. Definitely got to replace that and try to find a high quality one, because these have been known to be made with low quality rubber, and sometimes they have to get replaced almost right away. Here's the tensioner itself. Well, the metal was really grooved and almost all the way through, so gonna need a new one of those. Now there is some different kits available to convert to a hydraulic tensioner. I don't know if I'm gonna go that way with this motor. Maybe just get a new spring and go with it if we can find it. We've got the timing cover here. As I said earlier, somebody shoved in the wrong threads down here, so we're gonna have to clean that up. But you know, when you start looking at the timing and the timing gear, you know you're in trouble when the motor is dirtier inside than it is outside. Yeah, that's definitely cause for concern. So what can we say about the upper timing gear mechanism here? Well, you know, this is one I've had walnut blasted, and here's what came out of the car. So we got a long way to go to get this clean and clean enough to put back together. Now we're gonna put new chains on this, that's for sure. But there's a lot of talk about the sprockets here that drive the chain and how they wear. Now, I have a new one here. I'll show you what that looks like in comparison to an old one. I wish I had one that was more worn out to really show you guys what a worn one looks like. So what happens is the chain actually digs into the side of the tooth. And when it gets to the point where it kind of creates a ridge on the side of the tooth, that's when it's really worn out. Now, a lot of people say, oh yeah, well, it's worn when it's pointed over. But that's really just the side loading of the chain kind of eating away at the side of the chain. So, you know, I guess it's another point of wear. Some people replace all the sprockets. Some people just replace the lower sprocket. I guess we'll have to have a really close look at all this stuff and decide what to do. All right, before I turn the motor over, I wanted to have a look at the deck, see what we're working with. I cleaned it off, put the straight edge on there. Very, very minimal discrepancy. So it's usable in that regard. Now this deck still has the stamping numbers for the bore grade. That tells me that it's never been surfaced. The surface has never changed here. And it looks like a lot of the original pistons are here because they kind of match. The piston should be graded one letter higher than the bore. So you see there, here we see a G, H, FF to F, G to H, F to G, F to G. Now this one, this piston may have been replaced because it's a G to G and the piston looks a little different, has a stamping slightly in a different spot. So we might see that some of the lower end of this engine might be not original. And just wanted to have a look at the oil pan here. Took that off. Sorry you guys missed that. The only thing really interesting is this sender unit. It actually sends to a gauge on the dashboard and it relays the oil level And that's pretty interesting because we're in an era right now where BMW, they don't have a dipstick and they rely solely on a device like this. So yeah, pretty ahead of their time. Look at that, right on. Whoa, look at that. Oh, just there we are. Okay, thanks.
This thing float in here, does it?
Look at that.
It pivots up and down, doesn't it?
That's just aerodynamic, isn't it?
Floats in the oil somehow.
Got that motor flipped over. And my dad had the floating suction chamber. That's what they call it in his hand there. It moves up and down with the oil level to make sure the oil pump isn't starved. So the first thing I want to do is set up the dial indicator. I want to see what the end float of the crankshaft is so we can see if we need to order any new thrust bearings or not. That's pretty important to not forget before it comes all apart. Now I want to talk about the specification of what we see here. I'm going to geek out a little bit, so bear with me. This is a combination of some really early parts and some later upgraded parts. And so when you take apart these XK motors, they're not all the same. What do I mean by this? Well, yeah, these sludge plugs here, you can see this peened over kind of a machine screw in there. And those come out earlier designs. That was a Welsh plug in there that you couldn't easily thread out. So that's nice. Those will come out. They need to come out to clean out all the heavy metals that are in there, the lead and whatnot that's in the oil way. So really important to take those out. And I'll order six new ones of those and we'll clean those out and see what that looks like. Now getting to part numbers. Okay, so the crankshaft here we see it says C2239. And that's a very early crankshaft number, which kind of matches the year of the car being 1952. But according to the spare parts catalog, it should have a C4808. So I'm not quite sure what to believe. The parts catalog also says we should have a later type oil pump. This is a really early type oil pump. It has two gears. It mounts on the side of the main cap here. And these things, you can't buy them new. They have to be rebuilt in England. So this one's going to come off the engine and get rebuilt by specialists in England. Same with the water pump. And what else can I say? Well, one thing I want to do is check the main caps, make sure they're numbered correctly. So if we look on the block here, FF1, FF2, FF3, all the main caps should match those numbers. So I want to double check that. There is some marking here on the surface. It's not too much of a cause of concern, but it definitely doesn't look original. Has something happened to piston number one here? I'm not sure. Okay, well, let's see what this envelope looks like. Okay, let's measure how much this crankshaft moves fore and aft. Spec is from 4 to 6 thousandths. And if it's out of spec, we need different thrust washers. We'll need to order them. So here I go. I'm just going to gently move the crankshaft back. I can see the dial indicator there. It moved 10 thou. So what that means is I need to fit oversized thrust washers in this motor. Probably just one 4 thou oversized thrust washer to bring it back into spec. Because 10 thou is too much movement of the crankshaft fore and aft. Okay, next step, I want to take this pinned in sludge plug out. I like to use a hex socket. And I'll just give it a light tap to make sure it's well seated. I get the most contact possible. And I just jam the crankshaft with a wooden hammer. Oh, it just moved. Gotta find something better. Let's see here. Damn, that's in there. Okay, I put as much torque as I am comfortable with on this sludge plug. It ain't coming out. So I'm gonna get the machine shop to take off a little bit of material here so they can withdraw it without having to fight these really heavy pins on all four sides there. So next up, I wanna take this distributor drive gear out. It has a gear and a shaft and a driving dog. But before I do anything, I want to make sure that it's going to go back in the same position. So I put the motor back to top dead center on 1 and 6, made sure it's firing on number one, and just looked at that dog drive gear down in that shaft, noted the angle so I can get it right when it goes back together. So there's a bit of a process to getting this gear off the end of the shaft, and it needs to come off because I'll show you another angle. It's nestled right in with this last main bearing cap. This gear needs to come out before that cap lifts off. Okay, I don't want to put any stress on the gear when I crank off this nut. So I'm going to withdraw all this stuff off the crankshaft. So this distance piece, this is usually always an item that gets changed because the front seal, this is the seal surface and it's nice to renew. Okay, I'm going to try a puller because these gears are not moving with a light tap. So look at that, it's just sliding off by hand. So it must be that distributor drive that's really stuck on there. See it moving. Okay, it's off. Let's see if this will just come off of here. See method to my madness. It's pretty good. I got a bit of torque on there. It's on there. Just a little heat here. Okay, got it hot. Not really that hot. But, let's try this again. Okay, so I'm gonna try my best here with the impact. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna hold the 7/8 nut, put the extension on there, go from 3/8 to 1/2, and this fits nicely a 15 mil socket. So, and I'm gonna crank on that and see how it does. This should be it, really. This isn't it, I'm done. Cut it off. Send a prayer. There it is. Look at that. Holy. Okay, we're off. Finally. Holy smokes. Let me just tap this in and out. The aluminum punch here. It's going to end up on the ground. There we are. Look at that. So now we have clearance. We can take the main cap off. Woohoo! Okay, let's have a look at piston number one. We're here at the bottom, the big end of piston number one. Has these old school slotted nuts on here. And one of the cotter pins disappeared. Where'd that end up? Probably somewhere in the oil pan filter system there. Oh, good job, Rich. Okay, moment of truth. Looks pretty good, actually. Holy, clean it up here and have another look. Pistons all came out, and we'll go to the bench. I'll show you what they look like. But really, the crankshaft here, it looks pretty good. I mean, there's some staining here. What I'll need to do is take some accurate measurements with a mic and just make sure that these are within spec. And then we can just fit some standard connecting rod bearings in there, and the big ends. Now go to the bench here. We can see the pistons. And I was right. Piston number one was changed. How do I know that? Well, it's a different piston from the others. It has these grooves cut out in it. And, you know, a G piston and a G hole. That's kind of a telltale sign. So what do I think about these pistons? Well, they look like the original pistons because they were graded correctly. They're the split type piston, which is the later design, but they've been knurled. This is kind of an old school way to get around reusing the pistons in a rebuild. So we're gonna need new pistons for sure. Probably gonna go 20 thou over because I think these are the original pistons. Really, the only thing we're going to save here are the connecting rods and caps. The bolts were over tightened. They're regularly changed anyhow. See, that's the plan. I just got to strip these down, save the connecting rods. They've corroded quite a bit. See that? So I'm going to get them walnut blasted, get them looking nice, and move on. All right, next up, I want to take off the number one main bearing cap here. And there's a scroll and a seal here. So I think this is a pretty interesting area. I'll start with the main bearing cap itself. Okay, these main bolts should be 80 foot-pounds. Let's see, I got this torque wrench to 100. Oh, there we go. I think they were torqued correctly. Okay, let's ease this off of here. It's on with some dowels, so it kind of wiggles back and forth to get it off. One person in my last engine rebuild video said you can actually put the bolt back in and wiggle it as you pull it up, which is a great idea. Just going back and forth here, just gently getting it off. Okay, here's the first look at a main journal. Okay, so I'm gonna clean this up and have a look. Let's give it a wipe. That's all very normal, very good wear. Nice. Let's have a look at the crank. Has the same staining. A bit of a ridge actually here. Again, it'll be measured and we'll see. I think it's supposed to be 2.75 inches. I have to go look at the manual. Okay, next we'll take this off. Okay, I got those two screws out. Take this housing off. Oh, come on off of there. Again, we're fighting dowels. I'm gonna use my non-marking pliers here to take this off. Oh, there it goes. We got a wiggler. Okay, so here it is. This is the scroll. There's no seal. And what happens here is that the, I don't know, you can see it. Yeah, you guys can see this. So the scroll brings back the oil onto this slinger, which will then drop down into the bottom of the engine. Kind of down into this area here of this retainer. So it's important that it goes on the right way. If this goes on the other way, which is totally possible, it's gonna leak down onto the floor. So definitely gotta make sure this side is towards the inside of the motor. Now, as the bearings wear, this scroll can be worn down and it loses its effectiveness. So the modern solution to that is to grind it down to 75 mil and put a neoprene seal and get a new housing here that houses the modern seal. And I think that's a good way to go, especially if the scroll shows wear. So I have an interesting development to share with everybody here. I took off the center main bearing cap. I noticed the thrust washer was completely worn down. That's where that 10th out end float came from. And just having a look at the crank here, I think it'll come through. The thrust washer surface is all pitted, rust pitted. And what that's done is it's prematurely worn the thrust washer down. It's the same on both sides. I'll show you what the other side looks like too. So there's two approaches to solving this issue. One is to find a new crankshaft. This one has to be ground down on all the bearing surfaces anyhow. The other is to try to find some obscure like 10 thou over thrust washers and then cut this surface down on the crankshaft. So if anybody knows if 10 thou thrust washers are available, please let me know. Otherwise, I think we're on the hunt for a new crank. All right, down to the very last few steps on this engine block before it can get hot tank dipped and really cleaned out. And in preparation for that, I want to take out these plugs, these core plugs, frost plugs, Welsh plugs, whatever you call them, and maybe even this one if it's looking bad. Now, I think we're going to find a lot of corrosion in there. I know that because looking from the top of the block, I see a lot of corrosion down in there. So we're likely to find a lot of corrosion down near the bottom, I suspect. And I got to talk about these apertures. They send the cooling to the cylinder head. This one in particular, let's look at a close-up here. It's getting really small on the ceiling surface, but I think it's just barely enough. We're just going to barely squeak by with this block. I mean, the other fix would be trying to weld on the top of the deck. I don't have any experience doing that, and it's pretty risky from what I understand. You can crack the block when you weld it. So on the other side here, took out some of these plugs that open up the oil way. That's really good practice. To get that all opened up before it gets hot tank dipped. I think these were actually plugs that the factory used to plug up a drilling that sent the oil away to the other side of the block. Now, these frost plugs, they don't look like they were installed that well. I see a lot of little bashing and whatnot on them, but they actually look like they held. I don't see any leaks down the side of the block, so they did their job. They're kind of an old school Welsh type plug. And I'll show you my method for taking them out. Let's give it a try. Okay, this is the lowest plug right above the oil filter housing and the Jaguar symbol here. So let's see what we find behind it. Rust already falling out. There it is. Ooh, I see some crusty rust in there. Look at that. This is all block material here. Look at this all. Oh man, it's really dry. Holy, just full of powder and cake in there. Holy. Oh, good thing to get that out of there. It's all material lost out of the inside of the block. Good thing these blocks are cast so thick. Wow. Okay, well that does it for this episode of the XK Motor. Thanks for watching, everybody. And here you can see a different phase now where I've cleaned the motor, cleaned the head, ready for the machine shop. And I like to get these things really cleaned up as best I can before they go to the machine shop. This cylinder head, it's been walnut blasted after it went through the parts washer, mild phosphoric acid, cleans it all up, cleans that valley out. This thing isn't painted, so I really want to get that aluminum shining bright at me even before it goes to the machine shop. And oh boy, do I hope we can save this one. It's definitely been warped and decked, so it'll be a bit of a challenge to get this one back in the car, but I think we can do it. Keep the car matching numbers, keep the block and the head together after, what, 70 years? So what did I do to the block? Well, it's been hot tank dip. That got rid of all the oil. But to get rid of the rust, I actually give it a mild acid wash. And definitely have to, after the acid's on there, got to wash that, rinse that out of there. Can't leave acid on a block, that's for sure. And now, I don't know if you can see it just poking to the right there, but that's the XK150 project everybody wants to see. So please let me know if you want me to follow up on this XK motor, see how we do on that cylinder head, go through the parts ordering process, maybe see what we order in, maybe a little bit of the build and seeing it running. If you're interested in that, please let me know, because that XK150 in behind there is taking up all my time. So yeah, that cylinder head is looking pretty nice there. Then we got those core plugs. I was contemplating taking them out, but I didn't. And I think that's a good thing not to mess with those. And yeah, I guess that's it. That's the end of this episode. As always, if you have any tips, tricks, comments, or trade secrets, I love to hear from you guys in the comments below. All right, that's it. Thanks for watching, everybody. See you later. Bye-bye.